Welcome to Let Us Entertain You Again. My name is Stuart Rogers, and along with Chip Marchbank, I'm your co-host this evening. We have a wonderful show for you this evening. And did you notice that we got a notice in the Los Angeles Times? Today we are big time. Last year, it was the Mickey and Judy show, putting up the tent in the backyard. We even had a clown. This year, it is the Michael and Judith show at the reception. We're even going to have a reception this evening to which you are all invited after the show. And we would love to see you there. And this is a very prestigious show this evening. We have a number of very, very classy acts. As a matter of fact, you might compare it to the Academy Awards. Well, for one reason, it's going to be about as long as the Academy Awards. Feel very fortunate that we're not charging you by the hour. Anyway, we have some very distinguished guests this evening, too. We have some VIPs, and of course, everybody's here. Everybody in the district is here, and we have discussed the introduction of everyone. My God, the preparations of the introductions of our VIPs took us almost as long as the rehearsal itself. So I can hardly wait to introduce you to some of the very important people we have this evening that are joining. No, oh, that's right, Chip has it. Chip, Chip, could you come up here and join me? Chip Marchbank.
How are you doing? Yeah. Well, that's good.
So anyway, now, before we begin our program this evening with Chip's first number, Chip is going to introduce our VIPs. Sure. Chip, there you go. There you go. Because we have a lot of people, and we decided, you know, we don't want to overlook anybody because we, you know,
I don't think I have that piece of paper. I thought I'd given it back to you over before we came on stage.
Well, you know how she's going to feel about that.
I don't know how she'll feel, and you know who at the district is really going to be upset that he didn't get that call.
What's his face is going to
get? Oh, let me tell you.
Well, whenever Chip finds it, we'll take care of the VIPs. In the meantime, Chip is the new reporter.
Anybody that happened to be here last year remembers that the curtain hit me on the head. So I'm going to be real careful about that tonight. You notice that Stu and I decided we'd wear tuxedos this year, make it a little classier ourselves. I think the last time I had a tuxedo on was at a friend of mine's wedding. And kind of a cute story, a good friend of mine by the name of Big Ed decided he was going to get married. And so he asked me to be his best man. So I said, sure, I'd love to. So the rehearsal was going on, you know, the rehearsal was finished. And so he was out there talking to his mother-in-law-to-be, and she said to him, you know, and she didn't realize I was standing behind her. She said, you know, it's a little funny because he limps and he might take some, you know, people aren't going to notice you so much. And so anyway, she didn't realize I was standing there. So she turned around and saw me, and she was a little upset, you know, and a little embarrassed. And I said, I'll tell you what. I know the perfect way to hide the fact that I limp. And she said, what's that? And I said, I'll come out in a wheelchair. How's that sound? But anyway, as the wedding went on, one of the things I had to do was light these candles. And I'd never handled one of those candle lighting torches before. And so before the wedding, I told Big Ed that I was going to carry some matches in my pocket in case I put that thing out. And he said, oh, nobody ever does that. So anyway, we walked out, and we're supposed to light the candles. I put that thing up in the air, pushed it up, and caught the daggone thing with my finger, and put the flame out. So I had to drop it down and light it. And now the other guy's all upset because I'm way behind in time. So I finally get it lit, get it going, and we walk up a few flights of stairs, and I reach up and light the last candle, and I turn, and I fall over the edge of the stair, and do a somersault down the stair, and boy, that was a real sight, let me tell you. Anyway, some of my favorite heroes of all time were the Smothers Brothers. And when I started to learn to play the guitar, I think they were the first influence that I really had. So I'm going to start off tonight by singing a Smothers Brothers song for you. As I was walking by the shore, I happened there to see a woman's form, a lying there, as still as still could be. The dress she wore was gingham blue, her hair all tumbled down. It might have been my own true love, my sweetheart Jenny Brown. Her face was turned into the sand, 'twas who I could not tell. But on her hand a high school ring, a ring I knew too well. I grasped her arm, my heart stood still, and then I turned around. Oh, alas, it was my own true love, my sweetheart Jenny Brown. Oh, Jenny Brown, why did I treat you cruel? Gosh whiz, Jenny, there was tears in your eyes as you ran away from me, and now here I find you on the beach. You're all still, sandy, you have flies and stuff all over you. I stared into her lovely face, a face that used to clown. I saw one eye a flicker, then winking open round. Ha ha, she laughed and jumped up tall. I bet you thought I'd drown. What a rotten sense of humor has my sweetheart Jenny Brown.
Thank you very much.
Our second number on the show tonight is one of my favorite acts. I've appeared with these people numerous times, and they are wonderful dancers. We don't see enough of them. Their names are Randy Smith and Marla Carbine, and they are professional ballroom dancers. In addition to being a wonderful dancing couple, they are both very, very warm and gracious. And even though it sounds like Lawrence Welkish in tune, they are lovely to work with. So tonight, I look forward to introducing you to their dance waltz version of The Impossible Dream, Randy and Marla.
Thank you. Maybe someone else can come out in a minute? Of course, sometimes people have soliloquies in Shakespeare. Let's just wait a moment more and maybe someone else will come out. Oh dear. To be or not to be, that is the question. May? Line? And peasants slang alive. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind's eye to kill oneself or not killing oneself to sleep a great deal. But we are the stuff that dreams are made upon, and our lives are rounded by a little sleep. Horatio, neither lender nor borrower be, but to thine own self be true. There is special providence in the fall of the sparrow. Extraordinary how potent cheap music can be. Out, out, down, spot! I come to why that wealth live, Padua. If wealth live, happily in Padua. Rush up. It's Shakespeare. Start quoting him now. Brush up your Shakespeare and the women you are. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Line. Oh, my God, line. Oh my God! I am most heartily sorry, for I have offended. And I detest all my sins. Because I dread the loss of heaven and the pains of hell. But mostly, my God, for I have offended thee. I swear to do penance, to amend my life. Amen. Well, that's an act of contrition that Catholic school children say when they want to be forgiven of their sins. Catholic adults say it too, I imagine. I don't know any Catholic adults, so. When you call for a line, normally the stage manager gives you your next line to refresh your memory. Line. The quality of mercy is not strained, it droppeth
as a gentle rain on the spot below. When we have shuffled off this mortal coil, alas, poor York, I knew him well. Get thee to a nunnery, lie! Nunnery! As a child, I was brought up by nuns. And later, I went to high school, and I was taught by Benedictine priests. I rather liked the nuns. They were sort of warm. A little bit crazy. Lie. I also liked the priests, too. In fact, in my junior and senior year, I spent several weekends joining in with the routines. Prayers, then breakfast, prayers, then lunch, prayers, dinner, prayers, sleep. I rather like the predictability. Private Lives or Hamlet or something, and you get me rattling on like some maniac. I really apologize. I just don't remember attending a single rehearsal. You expected Edwin Booth to get me. I really apologize. A, B, C, D, E, F, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S. Hello. You must be Ophelia. Get in? This must be one of those modern Hamlets.
Thank you. That was Greg Harris, one of our theater students here, and that was the monologue from Actor's Nightmare. Very nicely placed. Now, our next number is one of the more prestigious acts that I was telling you about in the show. We not only have Sheila Brazier, one of our very, very popular deans, but Bill Hyde, philosophy professor, and the two of them have appeared before with the piano duet that they are performing tonight. And tonight, their number is going to be Mozart's Concerto number 20 in D minor, K466, second movement, otherwise known as Romance. Sheila and Bill Hyde.
Thank you. Thank you.
Isn't that wonderful? And now for a very, very striking change of pace. I want to introduce Yetta Benson, for those of you who have not met Yetta Benson. Now, Yetta is not really a person. She's more like a presence, half puka and half pixie. This performance marks Yetta's stage comeback after a serious illness, and she and her combo, which include Joan Barton on guitar and Willie Bettman on drums, are going to perform Broadway Baby and I Gotta Be Me, Yetta Benson.
Pounding 42nd Street to be in a show. Oh, Broadway baby, learning how to sing and dance, waiting for that one big chance to be in a show. Gee, I'd like to be on some marquee, all twinkling lights, a spark to pierce the dark, from Battery Park to Washington Heights. Someday maybe all my dreams will be repaid. Heck, I'd even play the maid to be in a show. Say, Mr. Producer, yes, I'm talking to you, sir. I don't need a lot, only what I got, plus a tube of grease paint and a foul spot. Oh, I'm a Broadway baby, slaving in a 5 and 10, dreaming of that big day when I'm working for a nice man like Ziegfeld or a wise man in a great big Broadway show.
Now for a change of pace. Whether I'm right or whether I'm wrong, whether I find a place in this world or never belong, I've gotta be me. Oh, I've gotta be me. What else can I be but what I am? I wanna live, not merely survive. And I won't give up this dream of life that keeps me alive. I've gotta be me. Oh, I've gotta be me. The dream that I see makes me what I am. That faraway prize, a world of success, is waiting for me if I heed the call. I won't settle down or settle for less, as long as there's half a chance that I can have it all. I'll go it alone, that's how it must be. If I'm not right for somebody else, then I'm not right for me. I've gotta be free, and I've gotta be me. Daring to try to do it or die.
Thank you.
I told you it was a change of pace there. And now, Bill Hyde again, and this time he will perform Chopin's Nocturne in C minor, Opus 48, number 1, the Lento. Bill Hyde. Are you impressed? The show is still apple pie, but this year it's apple pie a la mode. Now, our next performer is Jane Smith from the Cosmopology Department. And she is going to perform for us a lovely rendition of the Lord's Prayer. Now, Jane has been studying music for well over a decade, and she performs as a regular soloist at her church, the South Coast Christian Assembly in Laguna Niguel. Jane Smith, the Lord's Prayer. Now, our next number will be presented by the Disabled Students Service Ladies. Now, for those of you who don't know these ladies, they are not only extremely altruistic and giving in their work, but they are also exceptionally talented. And for those of you who might not have the opportunity to see some song sign before, you're in for a specific treat tonight. They're going to do three numbers for us, and their first one will be the signing of Barry Manilow's One Voice. Ladies.
Just one voice singing in the darkness. All it takes is one voice singing so they hear what's on your mind. And when you look around, you'll find there's more than one voice singing in the darkness. Joining with your one voice, each and every note of the rock, if hands are joined in fears of life, if only one voice would start it on its own. Need just one voice facing the unknown, and then that one voice would never be alone. It takes that one voice.
Aren't they marvelous? I'd like to remind everyone at this time that everyone that you've seen so far is either a faculty member, a student, an employee of Golden West College, and we're kind of proud of that. The next number, to me, is kind of a personal indulgence. I love classical guitar, and this young man called and just graciously asked if he could be included in the show. His resume is so impressive. He has studied and played with some of the international giants of classical guitar, including way to go, Stuart, you forgot the name of it. The Romero brothers. You all know the Romero brothers. I know the Romero brothers. And Kirk Holland is going to play three numbers for us tonight. And I think he's going to introduce them, so without any further ado, Kirk Holland.
And my first number for you tonight is a piece by Isaac M. Albinus. Thank you. Cello suite, cello suite number one, J.S. Bach.
Thank you.
lullaby. It's called Afro-Cuban Lullaby. It's arranged by Christopher Parker.
Damn that Stu Rogers. You know, I'd have been out here sooner, except he's had me crawling around on the floor back there looking for that stupid VIP list. Now he's got Carl Langston back there trying to write the list on a roll of toilet paper, because that's what the paper would find. Anyway, before we bring the next group out, what I'd like to do is tell you a little bit about the Rehab Fitness Program, which, of course, the function that we're having here tonight is all about. And about 8 years ago, Bruce Heckman, very good friend of mine and a physical therapist, and I got together and decided we needed to offer a program for people that have gone through hospital therapy and other type of rehabilitation and run out of insurance monies or don't have the funds to be able to continue on with some type of long-term therapy program. So when we got it together and we called it Rehab Fitness, we started bringing in people that didn't have a lot of money, and the program is really set up at a low, reasonable cost for people. And what's exciting about the program, as it's gone on over the years, is the fact that for you, or for me, to go into a weight room and push a weight, and we can actually see some type of benefits in short periods of time, where people that are in our program, they have to look at things like, wow, my shoe didn't wear out as much because I didn't drag my foot on the ground, or it was a lot easier for me to get in and out of the car than it used to be. And they make great strides, and every little thing to them is just something that seems like nothing to us, and it's fantastic for them. You know, in that program, it says that I'm the mover and the shaker for this Rehab Fitness Program. Well, two things are wrong about that. One, I never knew how to shake in my life. Secondly, I have a heck of a time moving anymore, but I guess I'd say that I'm kind of a motivator for the program. But the rock and the backbone that this program is built on is Bruce Heckman. And he's about to come out here with the doo-dah dancers, but before, or the doo-dah marchers, excuse me. But before they do, I want to say, and Stu asked me to remind you, that there'll be a short intermission after this. There won't be any food or beverage because, you know, we have the reception following, so we want you to save your appetite for that. But ladies and gentlemen, these people that are about to come out work their heart out, day in, day out, working in the Rehab Fitness Program, Bruce Heckman and the doo-dah marchers.
Mark.
Chip came out here and talked about rehab program, and we thought you would like to see some results of it. I came into this program a month ago in November in a wheelchair, so, and I'm very when you first come into this program, you fill out a paper that states what you would like to do, what the benefits are you want to be from it. And I can remember filling mine out that I would like to walk again, because I am a walker, and it was hard to sit in a wheelchair for a long time. I would like to thank y'all for coming, because your donations do help the rehab program quite a bit. And I would just like to thank everybody for coming. Thank you.
Well, I hope you're all enjoying yourself here tonight so far. Glad to hear it. It's a real, real honor and a privilege for me to introduce to you the next performer that we have here tonight. He's the man that hired me here at Golden West College 16 years ago. A little story I'd like to tell about him is that, you know, maybe a lot of you don't realize that my main job here is the athletic trainer to take care of the injuries that our athletes may have during a football game or any other sporting event that may go on here. And when I went through my first interview with Fred for the job, and it came time, they cut it down to a couple, and he had me come in, and he said, okay, you know, we're really considering hiring you, but there's one concern that a lot of our coaches have, and that is that, are you going to be able to take an injured player off of the field and, in a football game and get him off to the sidelines? So I said, Fred, let me tell you a little story. I said, in 1972, I worked with the LA Rams, and I was on the sidelines at a game, and there was a big pile, and the pile cleared, and one guy was laying down, and that was Merlin Olsen. Well, the other trainers were busy doing some other things, so I ran out there to Merlin, and we talked for a couple of minutes, and it looked like it was no big deal, a little sprained ankle, you know. So he got up and was going to help me off the field. So he had, I was going to help him off the field. And, he put his hand on top of my head and was kind of using me as a crutch to get off of the field. It was everything I could do to stand up, you know. So anyway, I was able to help get Merlin Olsen off the field. And Fred said, so that proved to you that you could get anybody off the field if you get Merlin Olsen off. And I said, hell no, it proved to me that I'm going to get two other guys to come out, take him off the field, and I'll just walk over and work on when they get to the sidelines. So anyway, ladies and gentlemen, one of my favorite people, Superman, Dr. Fred Owens, to sing for you.
Is there any other kind?
Saturday night is St. Patrick's Day, and I'm up here drinking with a dry throat. I mean, singing with a dark, dry throat. It's terrible. Anyway, we're going to give you a little Irish Eyes of Smiling. There's a tear in your eye, and I'm wondering why, for it never should be there at all. With such power in your smile, sure a stone you'd beguile, so now never a teardrop could fall. With your sweet little thing laughter like some fairy song, and your eyes twinkle bright as can be,
jacket and a dress Earl of St. Andrew's kilt and Argyle hose. Now that means Roz, his wife, is wearing an Eboyne outfit with a dress burgundy, long derry shirt, and Margaret, Meg, their daughter, is wearing an Eboyne also with a dress Cooper shirt. I guess that's opposed to a non Gary Cooper shirt. And they will perform a very old Scottish dance which combines the Highland and ballroom dance steps. It's a Scottish country dance, and it's called the Shepherd's Crook, the Stratton Family Scottish Dancers. Thank you.
that work?
Okay, thank you. Aren't they wonderful? Now, Meg will be back in a few minutes to give us another dance. Now, right now, we are arranging in the show from the sacred to the profane, and it's a little bit of the profane part right now, only we've sanitized it for the family audience, so don't be too alarmed. This next week, we're going to have a production open up in our Actors' Play Box called Lenny, and it is, of course, the life of Lenny Bruce. And one of our actors, as a matter of fact, the young gentleman who is playing the part of Lenny and also directing this show, is going to do one of the monologues from the show Lenny tonight. Frank Guerrero. Frank.
Thank you, thank you. I just got finished playing in a town called Lima, Ohio. Now, I don't know whether you people have ever worked in a small town. If there are any salesmen here tonight, you know what I'm talking about. There's nothing to do in these places. First day in a small town. You go to the park, see the cannon, you've had it. Second day, you give your picture to a delicatessen. If you can find a delicatessen. Maurice, thanks for the lean brisket, Lenny. Right next to Sheffield and his gourds. I mean, things are so bad in these places. You get into a cab, the driver turns around and asks you if you know a place where he can get laid. Culture changes in small towns. Very innocently, too. They have these big signs, you know, like those Italian submarine sandwiches? They'll have big signs like, Don's Big Dago, 35 cents. And think nothing of that. I picture one of these poor guys coming to New York, going down to New York, going down to one of those Coongilly stands run by the Brothers Nunzio. Yeah, what do you want? Hi, give me a big Dago, please. I'll give you a big dago, pow, right in the head. Lobotomy and chest x-ray in one shot. Really weird. So here I am playing in Baltimore, and I figure this place is really going to swing. Nada. You know what I've been doing ever since I got here? I've been going to the movies. But every theater in town is showing a different version of the same old dopey flick. Prison Break, behind the walls of wholesome prison. Let me show you what I mean. I will now take you to Prison Break. That movie you've seen 100 times because it's been made 100 times. Starring Charles Bickford, Frankie Darrow, Warren Heimer, Turhan Van, the woman across the bay, Anne Dvorak, and two hooker friends, Iris Adrian and Arlene Dahl. They're in the prison yard. The convicts are rioting. 18 prison guards are being held hostage. The warden is in his tower. All right, Dutch. You got 18 men down there. Men who've served me faithfully for many years. Give up and we'll meet any reasonable demands you got. Except the vibrators! Forget it, man, you're not getting them! Okay. Yada, 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 war! Never mind those Louis Armstrong imitations! Give up, Dutch, you're rotten, Mrs. Criminal! Yada, 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 yada! Shut up, you nut, you! I shouldn't have given that library card, moron! I don't know what to do with these guys. Maybe if I kill about 4 or 5 of them for an example. Give me Tower C. Hello, Tower C, this is the warden. Kill about 15 down there. The bullets call my wife. They're in the back of my brown slacks. Don't put me on the ones with the gray shirts. You know which ones that kill? Just a moment. Before there's any killing, I'd better get down there. Not you, Father Flotsky. Yes, I'm going down there. Father Flotsky, you don't understand. These guys are monsters. They got knives and guns. You seem to forget, son. There are things stronger than knives and guns. You mean, that's right. Jiu-jitsu! And now the handsome but eccentric prison doctor, Sabu. I want to be a sailor. You're corrupt. The men hate you. That's why they hate you and cut you. That is not the way to go killing people. That is why the men cut the men up. Get out of here, you big pillar, and take your turban with you. Now we cut back to the yard. Hello, Dutch. You don't remember Father Flotsky, do you? You don't. Do you remember Arthur Shields for Italian-Swiss colony wine? I see. Just think of me as a passing priest. Now come on, Dutch. You're not a bad boy. Killing 6 children doesn't make you all that bad. Come on and give me the gun, Dutch. Yada, 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 yada. Give me the gun, Dutch. Get out of here, Father. Give me the gun, Dutch. The rabbi is watching. And now we cut to death row where little Abby, the East Side Jewish kid, is going to get burned tonight. I burned up the heathen of that digging of a book. Oh, them Jews are always singing, man. I don't want to die. 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 Schmuck, you're a towers. All right, you mean the prison guards and... Look, I don't know what this is, but Dutch don't want to give up. And I got an election coming up, and it's dog-eat-dog up here. You know what I mean? Come on, Dutch, don't be crazy. You got 2 seconds. Listen to me now.
I'm not going to listen to nobody. Nobody in this whole rotten, stinking prison.
Dutch, Bubby, listen to me.
Who's that?
Well, it's me, Kiki, the hospital attendant. Don't stop up your good time. Give it all up for me, and I'll make a new life for us.
Oh, Kiki, you knocked up. All right, I'll give it up for you.
Woo! Did you hear that? He's going to give it all up for me. Did you hear that, you bitches in cell block 11? Did you hear that, Warden?
Yeah, I heard it. Yeah, I heard it.
Where are you going to meet our demands?
What do you want, you fruit?
Well, we want a gay bar on the West Wing. And one more thing, Warden.
What's that?
I want to be Avon representative of this whole rotten, stinking prison.
Thank you, Frank. All right. Our next act is one of the highlights of the entire show. We have Roseanne Wood and Deborah Rosen, who have both overwhelming academic and performing credentials that consume 2 pages on paper alone. But as impressive as they are on paper, they are even more astounding on stage. It gives me great privilege to introduce Roseanne Wood and Deborah Rosen playing Cordoba and Malaguena.
Thank you.
more yet to come. Now, this next act, Kathleen Gore is the young lady's name, and she is a vocalist. Now, Kathleen has been taking classes at Golden West. I've had her in my acting class, and she said she would like to participate in the talent show as a singer. I'd never heard her sing, but I knew that her talent was saw it sang as an actress. And well, she told me that she could sing. So I heard her for the first time today in rehearsal, and it was delightful, because she is just such a charming and vivacious and cute little gal. So the stage crew, all the guys were, you know, going about their business. One guy was sweeping up, and another guy was working on sound, another guy's behind a curtain. All of a sudden, she starts singing, and these heads start popping up all over the stage, you know, watching Kathleen. And you'll understand when you see her. I think she's kind of a 90s version of Betty Boop. She's going to sing Teach Me Tonight, Kathleen Doerr, accompanied by Monsieur Alan Giles.
I'm in no mood to resist.
ladies, from the Disabled Student Services. Ladies are now going to do Respect by Aretha Franklin. The profane is a lot more fun. Okay, our next number, Dolores Harper. Now, most Hawaiian music originated as chants. It was used to tell of daily living and as tributes to their gods. The music is solemn, and it's a sign of disrespect to smile or show emotion during the dance. Now, tonight, Dolores will perform two dances for us. The first, a traditional Hawaiian chant, E Pele'e, is a dance to the fire goddess Pele. And you will notice Dolores using an ipu gourd as a percussion instrument in the dance. Her second dance is a more modern melodic hula. It's a love song called To You, Sweetheart, Aloha. Dolores Harper.
Thank you.
Sullivan, eat your heart out wherever you are. All right, our next act, Alma Wyatt. Alma is a business professor here on campus, and she has performed over the years a number of times, and she's always in demand because she is such a lovely vocalist. She has a beautiful voice. And tonight she's going to sing two numbers, Schubert's To Music and Rodgers and Hammerstein's Climb Every Mountain. Alma Wyatt.
Christ, whom strict.
again, Maestro Giles. Now, as I promised, Meg Stratton is going to be back for a reprise. Now, this young lady has a wonderful future ahead of her as a dancer. She already has established herself not only locally, nationally, but literally internationally. And Meg now will dance a solo for us. She is currently the Western Regional Champion for Highland Dancing, and she picked up 3 first prizes in competition today before she came to the show tonight, incidentally. Now, being Western Regional Champion includes California, Nevada, Arizona, Utah, and Hawaii. All right. Now, Meg is wearing a Highland Dancing jacket with a dress diamond, a Perth kilt with Argyle hose. And Meg will dance to a number written in 1745 after the banning of wearing the kilt was lifted. The dance shows the happy Scot kicking off the trousers he was forced to wear and dancing to the joy of being able to wear the kilt again. Meg Stratton. Not only is that young lady a marvelous dancer, but last year she danced when she was 12 years old, and at the actual time of the performance, she was just surviving from chickenpox, which had infected the bottom of her feet, and she danced splendidly at that time. But in 1 year, she has grown from the little 12-year-old to just blossoming into a lovely young lady as well. Now, we have a reprise here for you from the gentleman who has taken care of the acknowledgement of all the VIPs, and also for all of you who he mentioned. I want to mention, to add that Chip is going to personally toast all of you who have celebrated here tonight at the reception afterwards. So please don't be in a rush to leave the campus, because he's going to take care of that obligation and honor after the show as well. So here we go with Chip's reprise, Mariah.
Before I sing, I'd like to thank you all for coming tonight. It really means a lot to us to have you show up and give this kind of support. In deciding what song I was going to sing on the second time tonight, I decided on Mariah for two reasons. Number one, it's my wife's favorite song, and number two, it's because I love her, so. Way out here, they've got a name, rain and wind and fire. The rain is Tess, the fire Joe, and they call the wind Mariah. Mariah blows the stars around and sets the clouds a-flying. Mariah makes the mountains sound like folks was up there dying. Mariah, Mariah, they call the wind Mariah. Away out here, they've got a name, rain and fire only. But when you're lost and all alone, well, there ain't no word for lonely. Well, I'm a lost and lonely man without a star to guide me. Mariah, blow my girl to me. I need my gal beside me. Mariah, Mariah, they call the wind Mariah. Mariah, Mariah, they call the wind Mariah.
Show has its pièce de résistance, the ultimate. And our next act here says it all. I am very, very proud to introduce our president, Judith Baez, our Lady of Golden West. She's brought back more life to this campus in 2 years than we have previously experienced in the last 10. I think it's safe to say that we not only appreciate and respect her, but that we love her as well. With great esteem, I present Ms. Prez, Judith Baez, singing Never on a Sunday and What a Difference a Day Makes.
As we celebrate our diversity, celebrate it, recognize it, and appreciate it, I realize that music has always been an international language. And I think tonight's program has proved it. The two numbers that I have selected were originally written in another language other than English, but both songs were translated in many countries and they became hits throughout the world. The very first song was made famous, and I've got to say this, by a woman. Her name was Melina Mercuri. The name of the song is Taperia tu Piria, which means the children of Piria. The translation has nothing to do with children, as you know. And the second song was written by a Mexican woman by the name of Maria Griver. And the name of that song is Cuando Vuelva a Tu Lado. The translation is When I Return to Your Side. And then the English version of it has nothing to do with anybody returning, but it has to do with a day. And I know that you will recognize the melodies. Tan sol y mani en la que digo y que tría y que te será fiel. Obsiza lana ejo en la que digo y que tría y que te será pelea. Posata megalos no la neyinu le ve. Tupiria. Cuando vuelva a tu lado, no me niegues tus besos, que el amor que te he dado no podrás olvidar. No me preguntes nada, que nada he de decirte, el beso que negaste ya no lo puedes dar. Cuando vuelva a tu lado y esté sola contigo, las cosas que te digo no repitas jamás. Por compasión une tu labio al mío y estréchame en tus brazos y cuenta los latidos de nuestro corazón. What a difference a day makes. There's a rainbow before me. Skies above can't be stormy since our moments last year. Oh, what a year. It's heaven when West on your menu. What a difference a year made. What a difference a year made. What a difference a year made. And the difference was you.
First number was accompanied by Jerry Schrader on tape, and again, Alan Giles, Dr. Giles, accompanied on the second number. Now, for our final number of the show, which segues into the curtain call for tonight, we have the Disabled Student Services. And yeah, I'd like to give the names of all of the lovely ladies who are participating in the act. Paula Macharo is basically the coordinator of the group. Maureen Commodore, Gloria Lair, Kathy Copeland, Rooney Beattie, Terry Anderson, Donna Weir, Anna Dean Myers, Aaron Wood, Nikki Wilkinson, and now for our final number, ladies, take it away.
Must come together as one. down.